Edward Giller graduated from Kemper Military Academy and completed an undergraduate degree in chemical engineering at the University of Illinois in 1940. After graduation, while working at the Sinclair Refinery in Houston, Texas, he invested $40 for 40 hours of flying lessons, and then another $40 for 80 hours of aerial acrobatics lessons. The first airplane he flew in the Army Air Corps was a Boeing Stearman's biplane in Stamford, Texas. After 6 weeks, he was sent to Randolph Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas, where he flew the basic trainer BT-14. Transferred to Lubbock, Texas in the spring of 1942, he flew the twin-engine Curtiss-Wright AT-9 and the single-engine North American AT-6. On May 29, 1942, he graduated from flying school and was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the Army Air Corps. While later stationed at an airfield in Oregon, he met his wife-to-be, Mildred Schmidt, as he relates to his son, Paul.
During the early part of World War II, I was training at Portland Air Force Base, which was a civilian airfield. United was using it to fly passengers into Alaska, and your mother was a stewardess on United. My good friend Paul Haper said, "Anybody want a date with a stew tonight?" I hold up my hand. And so she shows up with a blind date. We hit it off from there.
You dated my mom when she was still living in Oregon.
Her home was Grants Pass, Oregon, but she was flying out of Portland Air Force Base, and we were using Portland Air Force Base as a training base for the military side of the...
And then you got married. So here's a picture
of your
marriage. I had told my pilots, "Don't get married, we're going overseas." So you see, so much for my advice. And I decided I better marry. The Lord told me. I have a strong feeling about that. He told me, "You better lock her up." And so I proposed, and we agreed.
You told me that you went on a short honeymoon.
Yeah, well, we drove back to Mildred's home and kept going up the coast and stopped three times. And then I had to get back to the base to go to work again.
You had said that was during blackout periods. And yeah. And you had to have the cars with the blackout lights.
We drove with little tiny lights they put up on the fenders, blackout lights, which weren't much help, but I don't know, it must have made somebody feel better. But
you shipped out to Europe, right? You got married, and then you shipped to Europe.
The squadron was required to put up a bunch of pilots for overseas, so we went as a group of pilots on our way to Europe, and that's when we joined the 55th Fighter Group.
By the time the 55th Fighter Group arrived in England, two significant events had occurred. The first was Hitler's investment in air power, and the second was the lesson both sides had drawn from the Battle of Britain in 1940.
The Nazis symbolized a new sense of national pride and a chance for Germany to be great again. Hitler mesmerized his followers. He revitalized industry, put the nation back to work, and dismissed the terms of the armistice. Now was the time for Germany to reassert itself, to rearm with new weapons, especially warplanes for the new air force, the Luftwaffe. There were only three major types of aircraft that filled this role. The first was a legend, the Messerschmitt Model 109. Perhaps best known of all German Luftwaffe aircraft, it served in enormous numbers. Germany's second most prolific fighter, and certainly its most effective propeller-driven plane, was the redoubtable Focke-Wulf Model 190. Allowed into production only because it used less popular engines, the 190 saw service wherever the Luftwaffe fought. Heavily armed and extremely fast, the 190 was aptly named the Butcher Bird. But the speed and firepower of earlier propeller aircraft paled in comparison to the Luftwaffe's most advanced fighter, the Messerschmitt Model 262, the Jet. The gun camera, it was hoped, would record many kills. This time, kills against the British.
Captured German footage reveals the sophistication and power of the Nazi Air Force, the Luftwaffe, and the commitment Hitler had made to it.
Then, on July 16, 1940, the German Air Force attacked Britain with its bombers. The 109 was to act as escort.
The first great battle for air superiority in Europe occurred when Germany launched its air campaign over Great Britain, known as the Battle of Britain.
Fleets of Luftwaffe medium bombers and Stuka dive bombers, their crews confident in the protection of 109 fighters, made for British airfields. But the British had used the valuable time gained in the phony war well. And now, unlike Poland and France, they were prepared. More importantly, the British had a fighter that was a match even for the 109. The Supermarine Spitfire was about as fast as the Messerschmitt, and certainly more maneuverable. And Spitfire pilots had another advantage. They were fighting over their own ground. British Spitfires and Hurricanes sustained dreadful losses, but less than those inflicted on the Luftwaffe. In the summer of 1940, a few hundred Royal Air Force pilots and their planes were all that stood between Nazi domination and the free world. They were enough.
Winston Churchill famously honored the pilots of British Spitfires on August 16, 1940.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
Great Britain had been preparing for a German invasion, but by preventing the establishment of German air superiority, Hitler was forced to first cancel and then abandon an invasion of Britain. But the Battle of Britain had revealed the vital role of the air war over Europe in determining the final outcome. Both the Allies and Nazi Germany knew that they must prevail in the air war at all costs. Starting in 1943, then Captain Edward Giller joined the air war over Europe and flew 115 combat missions during World War II, including air cover for the Normandy invasion in 1944, from bases in the northern part of Great Britain.
The first airplane you flew was the P-38.
Yeah, we flew the 38s out of England.
And then you flew a little better airplane, this one. Can you tell me about that picture and that plane and what you thought about the P-38 and the P-51?
The 38s had problems at high altitude. Engines complaining about the altitude left two contrails. Germans would look up there and see a spot in the sky and see two tails, they knew it was a P-38 or one of their own. And so when we changed the 51s, at least one contrail. So that increased our ability to sneak up on a German. We learned to fly the P-51 by reading the book and going out and flying it, which was common in those days.
When you flew the P-38, you often talked about the temperature inside the cockpit. Was it a warm plane to fly at high altitude?
That was before we got 51s with the engine out in front, and we knew what a warm airplane was like, I'll put it that way.
You flew a lot of times in the war. Were you one of the little friends?
That was the way the Germans identified us as Americans.
And your main mission was to fly support?
Well, our main mission was to protect the American bombers from the German fighters.
The great air battle of Europe was still undecided. In February 1944, there was a sudden change. Our fighters were ordered to range wider, even at some risk to the bombers, to seek the enemy instead of waiting for him, and above all, to follow him to his destruction. A gigantic fighter battle raged across the European skies with victories by our fighters alone of 60, 85, over 100 destroyed each day. The fight came down from almost invisible heights to the final decision, perhaps only a few feet above the ground. Enemy warplanes of every kind and in fantastic numbers were splashed all over the landscape of northwestern Germany and occupied Holland, Belgium, France. The enemy often dispersed his aircraft in the woods fringing his airdromes. This was a crucial battle. Both sides aware of the coming events, and air domination itself at stake. Vetements could be attacked only through the front door. These copied Allied Invasion Day stripes failed to deceive our pilots. Always open season on this kind of sitting duck. The steady, relentless bombing of Germany went on without ceasing. Against the enemy's occasional desperate efforts to intercept, we maintained fighter escort every step of the way. But the sky was ours, and another great opportunity was ours. His teeming, widespread, intricate transportation system, feeding and supplying the great armies which he counted upon to throw our invasion forces back into the sea. Then something happened. The enemy's roads and railroads were struck with a mighty force of air power. They were tense days, crucial days, and both sides knew it. Our fighters, freed by their bitterly won victory in the air, became a dominant factor on the ground. These thunderbolts are dive bombers. They strike home. But by far the greatest, the almost paralyzing destruction they inflicted was by the burning, hard-hitting fire of their 50-caliber guns. They exploded locomotives by the thousand and burned freight cars in uncounted numbers. No train in daylight hours was safe. No marshaling yard a haven. The enemy's desperately needed rail transport system was shattered all over the map.
Do you have any particular stories that you remember about any of these missions that stand out for you?
We went on quite a few missions. Some of them lasted a half hour and some of them lasted 4 hours. And so they're all jumbled up in my memory box, so they're pretty hard to sort out. The one when I, of course, remember is when a 9mm shell exploded inside the cockpit from a German ground, I mean, ground strafing. And that put a piece of metal into my shoulder, and some fragments are still there, and caused me to go home and get in the hospital and get bandaged up. And the war ended about that time.
I read your logs. I read the log of your last mission, and you were strafing aircraft.
Yeah.
Very low.
right down in the trees of the aircraft.
Right down in the trees, and these anti-aircraft guns were hidden in the back. And you wrote that you were shot. Tell me about the flight home. What was that like?
Well, at first I felt like somebody hit me on the shoulder, you know, with a hammer. And so I flew, I had to fly with one hand. That's my left hand, my throttle hand. So we were pretty adept at flying the airplane with either hand, actually, in general. And so I put my hand in my shirt, it came out bloody, and it felt like it went through a hole in my into my chest. And I said to myself, I'm not going to be in the air very long. So I started thinking about bellying in and hoping the Germans would provide a flight doctor to put me together again. But it turned out the bleeding wasn't very much. And so I kept going and going. Home looked a lot better under those situations. And since the engine's running fine and there's no other fighters around, I ended up back at my home base.
And you called your wingmen in to fly with you.
I told him, I said, we're going home. I'm it.
This is a collection of medals that I've seen forever. Can you tell me a little bit about some of these and, if you remember, how you got them?
They're on there by their rank. They have rank like the highest ranks in the top longevity, we'll put it that way. And these are combat medals down here. And there's the Purple Heart and the Silver Star and the Legion of Merit, the Distinguished Flying Cross. And
the Purple Heart obviously means something, but do any of these other ones stand out for you?
Well, they're all part of a war that went on and on and on and on.